Thank you, everybody, and welcome to Summer Forum this Sunday, July 25th. Thank you all for joining us. And this is actually the fifth of nine summer forums that we will be having this summer. So this is the halfway point. So thank you, everybody who has been joining us so far. And we look forward to a fantastic second half. And we will be joined today by Stephanie Duer, who will be talking with us about water conservation. So a very, very timely and important topic to us right now, this summer in the state of Utah. And so we're extremely happy and excited to have her here. And very grateful that she's able to join us and talk with us about this topic today. All right, so I am going to hand over the Master of Ceremonies duties to Steve Grizzell, who will be introducing Stephanie. So I'm going to unmute Steve, and Steve, you take it away.
Thank you, Dylan. I'm Steve Grizzell. I'm a 20-year member of the church. And today's forum is about water and Salt Lake City. I never thought much about water until this year. Water supply is just a given. You turn on the tap, but it's suddenly become more important this year than ever before. And we have Stephanie Duer here to tell us about our water supply. Stephanie is the water conservation manager for Salt Lake City Corporation. She's a Westminster College grad with a Master of Professional Communication. And Stephanie teaches classes on landscape design at the U's Lifelong Learning. Stephanie, please tell us about our water supply and our landscape.
Hi, Steve. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for inviting me here this morning. It's really kind of you. And as Steve said, it is a very timely topic. But it's interesting, too, is because working for Public Utilities, which is a water agency, water is always in the forefront of our mind, not only in the moment, but also we look forward to next year, 5 years down the road. We have planning documents that are 40 years out. So it's a very important topic for us so that you don't have to think about it and worry about it. But there are times it's really important that our community be more attentive about water. And it's when we need your help to address how we use water. So whether it's regular conservation during the course of the year or as a year like this where we're in this exceptional drought, we call on community members to assist. A lot of times when I used to go out to groups to talk, I would carry the conservation plan with me and I'd hold up the plan. And so if you all want to pretend I'm holding up the plan, you know, I'd say, hey, everybody. So I'm the water conservation manager for the Salt Lake City Department of Public Utilities. And we have a plan to save water. How much water do you think this plan saves? And people throw out numbers and guess. And it's a trick question because what I tell them is, well, the plan doesn't save any water. It's just a plan. It doesn't use water. You save water. We all save water. So really in the end, it's important that the utility plan and evaluate and monitor and study. But in the end, it's really the work of our community that helps us achieve our goals. So I want to share some information with you about our utility, also about our water situation currently, our drought plan and our conservation plan. So I'm going to share my screen. Okay, so as I said, and Steve introduced, I'm the Water Conservation Manager for Salt Lake City Department of Public Utilities. I've been in this role now about 20 years and 1 month. And this is my third or fourth drought. So it's getting, I'm practiced, but it's also getting a little old and they're getting scarier. So you may not know this, if you happen to live within Salt Lake City, you know, our name is Salt Lake City Department of Public Utilities. But the utility actually provides water beyond the geopolitical boundary that is Salt Lake City itself. And we deliver water to Mill Creek, Holiday, Cottonwood Heights, and portions of Murray and South Salt Lake. So we provide drinking water to over 360,000 people and 14,000 businesses. And the industries we deliver water to range from strip malls with small stores or small salons or a astonishing number of tattoo parlors, all the way to oil refineries, bottling plants, airports, hospitals, manufacturing, all of that. So we have a really broad range of the types of connections, we call them classifications, that we deliver water to. And we've been doing this, by the way, a little odd fact, Salt Lake City Public Utilities is one of the oldest retail water providers in the Western United States. And we're one of the largest retail water providers also. So that's a little map of our service area. So most of our water comes from surface water, which is the canyon streams, which accounts for 50 to 60% of our water. Some of that canyon stream though is right here from the Wasatch Mountains, but some of our canyon water, some of our stream water comes from the Uintas as well as the Colorado Basin River drainage system. So we get water through our canyon streams, through the Provo River Project, which is the Central Utah Project, which is the big water project that brings in water from the Colorado River Basin. And we get that water through the Metropolitan Water District of Salt Lake and Sandy. And then we also have ground water. So we have some wells and springs that we utilize mostly during the summer months when we have increased in demand. Otherwise we hold that water back. Now we actually have some of our own storage. Mountain Dell and Little Dell reservoirs are public utility facilities. So they're part of our infrastructure. Other reservoirs are Strawberry, Jordanelle, and Deer Creek, and then some other big tank type of big in-ground or underground storage facilities. The complexity about our water system is some of this stored water we have to use within a certain period of time. The water that comes out of the Colorado River Basin, we're only allowed to hold that for so many months, like a year to 2 years, depending on where the water is stored. So we tend to use that water first so that we can maximize that supply. And then we keep our water in Little Dell and Mountain Dell. We try to hold that back as much as possible because that's one of the sources and strategies that helps us get through droughts, because that water we can hold as long as we can. So as you think about conservation and using less water during the drought, picture Mountain Dell and Little Dell reservoirs. And the less water we use right now, the more water we hold in those reservoirs for next year. So I wanted to share with you some information about the drought itself. This is an exceptional drought. It's not just affecting Utah, it's affecting the entire Western United States and even portions of the Midwest in terms of the Northern Midwest. This is a map that's out of the US Drought Monitor, which is housed in at University of Nebraska, Lincoln. And what it shows, if you look at this map, the very dark red and the medium red are extreme and exceptional drought. And you can see that Utah, every part of Utah is either in an exceptional or extreme drought, as is a good part of the Intermountain West. And on top of that, we have the heat dome that was sitting over the Pacific and Northwest, which has caused these really high temperatures. The additional part, the other part of the drought right now that's really affecting things, and it's something folks may not think about, is soil moisture. So before this year and this drought, last year was the hottest summer on record. And it was also one of the driest, which meant going into the fall, all of our soils, both in the valley, but up in the mountains as well, were exceptionally dry. So as the snow came finally, and there wasn't a lot of rainfall last year, I'm going to take a step back. So an ideal scenario is coming into fall, we have ample rainfall so that the soil gets moist, the soil in the mountains gets moist. And then when the snow falls, that ground is already moist, it freezes, the snow sits above that soil, and come spring when it melts off, the bulk of that snow melts off and flows into streams, which then flows into reservoirs and water treatment facilities and into our creeks to support our ecosystems that are within our urban environment here and within the drainage basin. Last year, if it was one of those situations where everything that could have gone wrong did. So we had no fall rainfall. We had an exceptionally dry introduction into winter. Soils in the Wasatch and the Uintas were very dry. We had late freezes, so the ground didn't freeze until much later in the season. And when the snowfall finally came, it was below average. So that now as the snow melted off this spring, most of that snow didn't make it into the creeks. It actually percolated into the soil, which was necessary for our forest health, but it doesn't help our water supply. So on top of having a below average snowpack, lower than average rainfall, we also had exceptionally dry soils. And now on top of that, we've been having these intense heat waves, which has exacerbated the problem. So this is sort of all the worst case scenarios. And quite frankly, this is also, climate change is no longer a theoretical discussion or construct. This is climate change. This is what things could look like. So the utility works very hard with a number of universities to identify and improve modeling to help us identify more specifically what our future hydrologic cycle and patterns look like so we can plan for that. And we're working with a number of universities and climate experts and the Utah Climate Center to refine our understanding of what this means for us for our future. But this may not be a blip. This could be part of what our future looks like. It may not be this bad all the time, but just as another thought, tree ring data collected by the United States Geological Society, USGS, has identified that in the 1930s, when they were establishing the water shares along the Colorado River Basin and creating all these water systems that have delivered water into the western and southwestern parts of the United States and into California, were developed during a time of exceptionally high water, a historical high flows. And that's when those compacts were all developed. Since then, we've never had those flow levels. And actually, what we've been experiencing the last 20 years with these periodic and short-term droughts is actually more what historical tree ring data shows us as being normal. And that the years between 1930 and 1960 might have actually been wetter than average, not that this is drier than average. So these are all the kinds of things at the utility that we're examining and analyzing so that we can be as prepared as possible and provide our community and our city leaders with good information so they can set appropriate and thoughtful policy that help us sustain our community into the future. So we do have a water shortage contingency plan. It's not called a drought plan because there may be other reasons we have service interruptions. You know, like last year we had earthquakes and we had record wind, like we had hurricane level winds, all kinds of things we did not anticipate. I mean, we planned for, but honestly, as I was writing these documents and thinking of earthquake, hurricanes, that doesn't happen. Well, they all did. But we plan for that. So we could also have contamination or there could be a wildfire that affects one of our drainage basins. So that's why we call it a water shortage contingency plan. For brevity, I'll just refer to it as the drought plan. It was adopted in 2004. It contains, it identifies the stages of drought. It identifies triggers of those stages and it is codified. So our city ordinances identify that during certain stages, we have at the utility have the authority to restrict certain types of water use or if not restrict them, limit them also. Just as a thing, the city codes are divided into all kinds of chapters. And one of our complexities as a utility is though we're a municipal water provider, meaning we're a city retail water provider, we provide water to other cities. So our ordinance that supports our drought plan is in what's called Title 17, which are those parts of the code that grant the utility, the authority to regulate anyone who uses our water, so that we have the authority to implement and enforce our drought ordinance outside of our city boundary, just to be clear. It's not just a city code, it's the utility's authority to implement these plans across its across the entire utility service area. Another component of the drought plan is what we call the response summary. So there's technical language around how we identify various drought triggers, but additional to that is what do we do when we're when we're in a particular drought stage, and that's where the response summary comes in. So there are behaviors and practices that are identified, broken out into the various customer classifications, like single family homes, businesses, institutional properties like government properties, schools and churches, and industrial property or partners, so that we can identify different kinds of behaviors for different types of groups, because not everyone uses water the same way. So the response summary is broken down by stages and also by customer classifications and by these practices. Now, the way we've identified the triggers, and I admit, so right now we're updating the drought plan, the water shortage contingency plan, and this summer has been very informative. And it's not to say that I'm grateful that the drought happened, but the timing at least is helping to make sure that our next version of the drought plan is more responsive. Because one of the shortcomings of our drought plan is that, and I'm comfortable talking about its shortages because I wrote it. So the only person here I'm putting heat on is me. But at the time, there wasn't the political will to enforce and create strict restrictions. And so restrictions start on municipal and institutional properties in stage two. Actually, what it is it's more like mandated actions, and then water reductions begin in stage three for those same kinds of properties. They don't begin for residential or commercial properties until stage four. And observing behavior this year, I know we need to start those restrictions much sooner, and we will. Now, one of the good things we did with our water shortage plan is we don't just look at supply as a trigger, we also look at demand. So that any point in time, even if we're not in a drought situation, but say our community, for whatever reason, something is happening and we're using more water than is wise, or that might raise concerns about impacts on supply, we can actually invoke a stage of the water shortage plan and require reductions in water use. It also makes our community a direct partner in our ability to sustain ourselves through a drought, and to have the water supply reserved that will help us be a resilient community. So our community members are direct partners in our ability to weather a drought, if you will. Now, this is sort of a summary of the response summary I was mentioning. So you can see that there's five stages, beginning with advisory, moving to critical. We have goals identified that are based on water supply, but there's a linkage also to demand. There's information about what the response ought to be, and then which classifications of water users are obligated under those best practices. So right now we're in a stage two, which is mild, which is a misnomer. And one of the things we're going to look at as we update this plan is changing some of these labels, because I think they don't represent the situation. If you're needing to reduce water use immediately by 14%, that's not a mild situation. So all of this is going to be updated. But generally, for most of our customers, all the actions are voluntary. Folks are doing a really great job, and I have some more information about that in a moment. Institutional properties have mandated responses, though. And that would actually include the grounds around your church. Right now, any property, so institutional properties are government facilities, whether it's city, county, state, one of our member cities, or a federal institution or installation. It's not just parks, it's any of the properties associated with these facilities. They are required to either limit their watering to to the watering schedule, which is twice a week, or if they have what's called a irrigation-only meter, they have to stay within their budget. Now, again, not a great label. Irrigation-only meters do not deliver irrigation water. They deliver culinary water, but for limited to outdoor water use. And this is part of our rate structure. And so properties that have meters that are dedicated to just outdoor water use are assigned budgets based on the landscapable area and a historical evapotranspiration, which is the theoretical volume of water that a landscape needs. So all of these budgets have been established, and irrigation-only meters have, they begin their billing in tier two, which is what outdoor water use, reasonable outdoor water use. And that's a whole, we can get into water rates if you guys want to later on. That's a whole other lecture. But they're required to stay within their budget. Now, everybody else, and that would include your property if you had an irrigation-only meter, or you're limited to two waterings a week, schools, government buildings, all of those institutional properties. In stage three, should we move to that, those same properties will then have to reduce their water use up to 15%, and we'll identify the volume of water we need for reduction. And then the next stage would be where we have restrictions on all other classifications. So single family homes, multiple family homes, commercial properties, industrial properties. The proposal for the new updated plan will be to start those reductions in water use much, much sooner. And one of the things as a thought to this is, a lot of this in this iteration of the plan was sort of an all or nothing approach. And what we've learned in the ensuing 15 years is that there's a lot of space in between standard conserving behavior and really extreme reduction in water use. There's a lot of area in there. And so what we're working on right now with our city parks and in all of our member city areas and other institutional properties is to identify strategies to reduce water use earlier, but also to prioritize properties. For instance, not all Salt Lake City properties have the same level of use. We have grass around some office buildings. We have grass around City Hall, but we also have lawn at Liberty Park and Pioneer Park and some of our neighborhood parks, which is really important lawn in terms of having community spaces. So one of the thoughts would be that rather than waiting till stage two to tell institutional properties they have to stay within their budget, in stage one, we may mandate it reductions for less critical properties so that we can start reducing water use much earlier on, so we can save water in our reservoirs earlier into the system or into a drought. And we're looking at that for all of our customers. So there might be that as we update the drought plan, there might be restrictions earlier on residential and commercial properties, but it's so that we can make sure that we act soon enough and have the authority to act soon enough so that we can make sure we have adequate supplies of water. Because especially if droughts start coming more often and they have steeper impacts, we need to make sure we can hold water in storage. Because one of the things that we're mindful of and we need to educate the public better on is, let's say this winter we have a great snowfall and there's a lot of snow up in the mountains. That doesn't mean we're over the drought in terms of our water supply. It takes time for groundwater to recharge. It takes time for reservoirs to recharge and fill up. So it may take us several years of good snowfall to get out of a drought scenario in terms of water supply. So we need to act sooner so we can be much more responsive, or we can be, as we know, we need to be more responsive, but we'll have the authority to be more responsive sooner on. So some of the things I want to share with you is what to do about the drought right now. And I've got a set of tips. So for landscape, for general outdoor use, and for indoor use, because we need to think about indoor use also right now. That's just as critical. So it's conservation and saving during a drought is not just an outdoor sport. So some of the things you can do outdoors right now in terms of your landscape is just water less. whatever your watering scenario is, just water less. Now, the best way to do this is not to, let's say you have an automatic sprinkler system. If you don't want to reduce the volume of water you deliver each irrigation system necessarily, you want to increase the numbers of days between the times you water. So as there are, we have information on our website about how to schedule. And so I don't want to go into that detail here, but just adding days between your watering events will help. Also, don't rip out your lawn and replace it with gravel or plastic or artificial turf. We have one of the values in our valley is our urban forest. And gravel and artificial turf increase heat island effect. We are working with USU to find funding so that we could that we can institute a study to determine how much additional water is needed by our urban forest and other existing landscape as urban heat island increases. Gravel and artificial turf can increase the ambient air temperature around a building by as much as 20 and 30 degrees. And that's going to have an impact both on our cooling demand, which is in many cases, it's based on hydropower, but it's also going to have an impact on how much water our landscape needs generally. So it's not a great solution. There are other solutions and strategies, and you'll find them on our website. Manage your controller. I call a lot of businesses and they'll say, well, we don't really know where the shutoff is. We don't know where our valves is. Someone else, you know, we have a property management company. Those are excuses. And if it's your home, same thing, it's just an excuse. So learn how to operate your controller, shut it off manually if you need to, know how to set the timer so that you're watering appropriately during the course of the season. We should not be watering in April and May like it was July and August. And actually come mid-August, you can really cut down on watering because nighttime temperatures are beginning to decrease and day length is shortening and plants don't have as high a water demand in August and September as they do in June and July. Don't assume you need to water. A great tip is to take a screwdriver and insert it into the soil. And if it's really dry, you won't be able to get the screwdriver in. But if your soil has any moisture, you'll be able to get that screwdriver in. In which case, even if it's in a couple of inches, then you don't need to water. Prioritize your watering right now. Right now we're in a drought and it's pretty serious. It doesn't mean you have to abandon your landscape or risk our urban forests. So prioritize trees, mature shrubs, even your veggie garden over your lawn. Lawns are actually really resilient and they're not really the culprit of excessive water use. People are the culprit of excessive water use. It's not necessarily our landscape that we've chosen. It's the kind of lawn we choose and what we expect it to look like, but it's not lawn in general. But lawn is resilient and it's fairly easy to replace. So prioritize your trees and other plants in your landscape and let your lawn just go gold. Pile on the mulch in your non-lawn areas. Don't fuss about the brown spots in your lawn. Like I said, your lawn's resilient and will come back. Leave clippings on your grass. Those clippings, that's not the cause of thatch. We don't really have a thatch issue here. But if you leave the clippings on your grass, one is you won't have to fertilize as often. And also it helps improve the soil quality because it breaks down. But the other part of that is that it cools the soil, like mulch, and so that your lawn needs less water. Check your sprinklers regularly. And if that means you have to turn them on during the day periodically so you can walk around and inspect them, do so. Make sure that you don't have broken, cracked, or misaligned heads. That's really important because that's where a lot of waste comes into play. Also, the last tip for outdoor water use is mow high. If you let your grass, there is a direct relationship between blade length and root depth. So the longer you let your grass grow, the deeper your roots will be. So raise the deck on your mower and aim for 3 to 5 inches in blade height, grass blade height, not mower blade height. Oops. If you need more information, that wasn't really an oops, I forgot I rearranged the slides. This is a great website. So if you want information on how to water your landscape or alternative landscapes, we established this website a number of years ago. It's SLC GardenWise. It has examples of landscapes all throughout our service area lots of different styles, but all of them are either moderate or very low water landscapes. And it has a plant database, virtual garden tours, lots of great information. Other general outdoor tips is sweep your driveways and walks and stuff. Don't hose them down right now. If you have a pool or you manage a pool somewhere, lower the water level by at least 4 inches because that will help minimize water loss to splashing. You can get a rain barrel, although right now, you know, in a drought, rain barrels, that's kind of a future dream. But we had rain the other day, and if you happen to have a rain barrel and had it out, you were able to capture some water, which could help water plants or, you know, container pots or something. And the last thing, and this is a really important thing, is get a water check. They are free. We are in partnership with Utah State University and the Metropolitan Water District of Salt Lake and Sandy. And the vast majority of households that get a water check, one is they learn a lot about their irrigation system, but they also learn about how to, about things they could do to the irrigation system to make it more efficient. And it's free. And actually it could be for your home or your church site or your office building. Now, indoor tips, manage your leaks. Households, there's a study that came out a number of years ago, which has been repeated often, and this number has not changed, which is really sad. So we actually lose about 13 to 18% of water use indoors with leaks. So be on top of it. Dripping faucets, other kinds of leaks, toilet leaks are a big part of this. So manage the leaks. Faucet control. Stop the flow. Like if you're not actively brushing your teeth, shaving, washing your hand, like rinsing your hands, turn off the water. Every minute you save that water is off, you're saving gallons of water. Also turn down the flow. A lot of times it's a real habit when you turn on your faucet to turn it on almost full. But when you do that, when you put your hands underneath it or a pot to rinse, water splashes a lot and a lot of that water is not really being used. By actually slowing the flow of the water, you can use more of the water and less of it is wasted. And it doesn't take the task any more time. Another thing to consider is capturing the flow. If you're turning on the faucet to get it hot or cold, capture the flow in a carafe. I have one handy. And use it for drinking water, for watering your houseplants. Gray water has some concerns in terms of outdoor water use. If you're using, if it's gray water out of a sink, if it's has salt in it or soap, I'd be mindful of not doing that. But certainly water that's being like you're using for rinsing or draining or things or changing the temperature, capturing that water and using it is really a good thing to do. Take shorter showers. I know you keep hearing this, but yeah, it's a simple thing. Even just a minute or two makes a difference. Ignore the ad. It's very cute, but only run the dishwasher when it's full. Because honestly, dishwashers are really efficient, but if you're watering, using it every day, it's less efficient. Use it when it's full, test your toilet, lift the tank, squirt in some dye, like a strong color, like red or orange, cover the tank back up, and then wait about 10 minutes. If the water in your bowl turns color, it means you have a leak. It's typically a gasket. It's not a hard fix. We have information on our website about how to do all that. And then be a whistleblower at work. We don't just use water at home. We use water in the places we go to do business or in the places we do business. So let your facility manager know, the building manager, or me know that there's a problem so that it can get fixed and addressed. Now, we do have a water conservation plan. It was adopted by City Council last December. And again, it's for our full service area. You can see on this chart that the total use in 2001, what that looked like, and that's the solid blue line, and where we are is that block of color. The green is our outdoor use, the blue is indoor use. Where we need to get is where that lighter green line is and the lighter blue line. Now, this isn't for the drought, this is just conservation. Over the last 20 years, we've reduced our regular average water use by about 25%. So we save about 16,000 acre feet of water every year that we didn't save before, but we need to double that effort. actually, to be able to sustain our water supply through the next 40 years. And there's more information about our conservation plan on our website. This is just a summary, but we've actually broken out the water use reduction needs for conservation through quite a number of customer classifications. Commercial properties get a little, that's a squishier number, in part because there's so many different kinds of businesses. We're doing analysis right now so that we can help understand how much water do car washes need to reduce? How about a beauty salon? How about a grocery store? So we have a lot of different kinds of uses, and we're trying to create goals much more specific for our commercial customers so that they can be better partners in this. I wanted to share with you a bit of good news too. This is a daily water use chart. Now, every single day, the utility monitors and measures water that comes in as source water and that's treated and used by our community. So what you see here is the light blue line was our historical water use in the year 2000, the year before our conservation programs began in earnest. The red line is the average for the last 3 years. In this case, it's 2018, 19, and 20. The blue block of color is our daily water use right now. Now you can see that earlier this spring, people were watering a lot. It was really dry. They were concerned about their lawns and their landscapes. I was really concerned about what the pattern might represent for the coming year. So we started increasing our messaging. And then fortunately, somewhere early June, we had that little cold snap. People kind of came to their senses. We put out a lot of messages. The state started putting out messages. And you can see that our water use is reduced a lot. And what's really good to see is that sustained across this incredible heat we've had for the bulk of June and into July. Now, our daily demand back in the year 2000, this is our peak demand. This is how much water we used on the highest demand day of the entire year. That year was 218 million gallons in a day. We now average as a community around 170 million gallons as our peak demand. Now, that's not our daily demand, that's peak. Right now, our peak was about 160, but we're averaging right now between 130 and 140 million gallons of water a day. This is astonishing given the heat, and I am so impressed with our community efforts. So those of you who are doing a good job and helping, thank you and kudos to you. If you're not helping, get on it now, because we don't have time to waste. And you know who you are. And I've never been in a room where I'm saying, who's not helping, who's wasting water? No one ever raises their hand. So help now, because now we need help. All of the rest of you, thank you. So thank you so much. If we can open it up for questions, I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. If you want more information, visit slc.gov/utilities/conservation.
Thank you, Stephanie. That was very informative, particularly given the current situation. And I would add that the information you provided is really well presented on the website for Salt Lake City Public Utilities. I went through the types of plants and different ways to landscape and variety of water saving measures. Well done and easy to read.
Thank you. And we are updating our pages. We're adding more information and we're reorganizing it. So it flows better. And we have some new programs coming on, like I didn't even talk about water maps or the rebates that are coming our way, landscape rewards. So all kinds of stuff happening really soon.
So we have some interesting questions, and I'll group it by the political versus the practical, although I don't mean to apply political to not practical.
I can go either way.
All right. First question, how often and how should I water trees? What is a drip line?
Okay, so that's a great question. And so some of my So before I went to work for the city, I actually was a landscape designer and contractor for about 15 years. So I have a lot of certifications and stuff. So my information isn't just anecdotal. I just want you to be mindful that I'm speaking. And then the reason I'm saying that is I'm going to couch this. It says it depends. It depends on the kind of the tree and the how old it is. So newly planted trees, so anything within the last 3 years, you should be checking the soil probably every week to 2 weeks. Using your hands or using that screwdriver are a great way to do that. As a rule, for every inch of caliper width, which is basically the diameter around the tree, that tree needs about a gallon of water. So a big tree might need 10 or 20 or 15 gallons of water every time you water it. And it should be delivered around the drip line. The drip line is if you picture where the branches are and where the branches end, the drip line is actually to that point and just beyond. And that's because trees want to optimize their water uptake. The canopy can shed water away from underneath the tree. So roots learn to grow. They don't learn. They're not sentient in that same way, but they are very resourceful and survival, and they survive. They grow out past the branches of the tree so they can optimize their water uptake. So really, when you think about the ideal place to water the tree, it's where the branches end to just past. So in that area. Now, that doesn't mean you leave the area just underneath the tree really dry, but putting a little bag at the trunk of a tree or putting your drip, your sprinklers or something at the trunk of the tree doesn't help. So you want to be watering out towards where the branches end and just past where those branches are. As a general rule, most trees, if you water them, say, every 2 weeks, you should be fine. Now, there are some trees that are much more water heavy. Almost every maple, sycamores, fruit trees are going to, especially if they're in production, they're going to need water more frequently, and it might be weekly. So it helps to know what kind of tree you have. We actually have this information on our website. If you go to the SLC GardenWise, if you go to the plant database and look up your plant, we have information there about how much water the tree should receive. But as a general rule, water where the branches end, and mature trees that are well established every 2 weeks, 10 days, younger trees or maples, sycamores, fruit trees, it might be every week.
This is a fun one.
Can I add one other thing?
Sure.
Evergreen trees. The key time to water evergreen trees is fall and spring, by the way. They're really drought tolerant during the summer months. They're not growing as actively once they finish candling, which is when that little bright green thing comes up and then expands into growth. But if you water your evergreens, whether it's a yew or a spruce or a pine tree, in that shoulder month, October, November, and then say March and April, you'll be able to water less during the summer months and your tree will be really healthy. Just a thought.
That is great information. Here's a fun one. I saw two people windsurfing in Little Dell yesterday. Is that okay?
I believe non-motorized vehicles are allowed, but I'm not certain, and I can check with Watershed. Because I know they've changed some of the rules, and I don't know if because of the drought that they're not letting people in, and that may be the case. I know historically they allow non-motorized, like canoes and things like that. But I don't know, so I'll check, and I'm going to make a note of that question. We'll find out.
Should we be aware of rattlesnakes and other wild animals looking for water in our yard?
I suppose so. It depends on where you live. I think that's always the case. We get wildlife into our landscapes and you know, frankly, pretty much everywhere we build a house used to be wild land. So we have to be prepared for the fact that we're going to have birds and other things and reptiles. So, yeah.
Okay. I'll pay attention to rattlesnakes when I mow the lawn.
Although I wouldn't expect them in the grass. Rattlesnakes are more like a gravel rock kind of creatures. They like the sunny spots.
So is that another reason why not to put gravel on our parking strips and lawns?
Oh, see, there you go. Unless you want to create like little, that would be fun though. I would do that for a little reptile habitat.
That's it. I was amazed at your answer, by the way, on parking strips. That was totally counterintuitive to me.
Oh, excellent.
Not putting plants or grass on it. The inland port has come up twice.
Yeah.
So the first question was, what will the impact of the inland port be on our water supply?
I'll tell you. So we do a lot of planning, and the planning starts with analysis and evaluation and monitoring. And we recently updated a document that's called the Water Supply and Demand Master Plan, and then also the Major Conveyance and Storage Master Plans. So, and the reason we updated these documents now is because of things like the prison and the inland port and densification, just so that we could better understand the impacts of these issues on our demand and supply, and also to be able to provide better and science and fact-based information to our political leaders so they can make good decisions. And so, yes, of course it will have an impact. We don't know what that will be because some of it depends on what kind of businesses they allow in there. We've recently are working on calculating a volume of water as a maximum delivery for an industry, maximum daily delivery. I think they're looking at 30, I think it was, I don't remember the number. I just heard it the other day, and it's similar to the number in New Mexico and Arizona in terms of a maximum volume of water use. So we are looking at a way to identify the kinds of businesses and industry we want so that we don't have, say, another oil refinery or a microchip manufacturing or something like that that is a really high demand, or even a water bottling company that might take our water out of our basin and sell it elsewhere. So yeah, we are considering that and trying to, and they're doing research right now around that so that we can make really good recommendations and set good code.
Would the inland port be treated as just a regular institutional user of water?
If there is public access space, or if there's space there that's being governed by either the port authority or the state, then that would be institutional property. If there is property that is managed by businesses, then that would be commercial or institutional. So it would depend, or commercial or industrial. So it depends on property ownership or whose name is on the water bill.
How do you and your department interact with the state to deal with water policy politics?
Wow. So you guys, any reporters in the room? Is my boss here? No, I just, no. So there's a couple. One is we work to partner with all water interests throughout our region, our service area, and the state. One of the things that we did is, for instance, there's the Water Task Force Board, and our utility director attends those meetings regularly. So we have department, we have people within our department who interface with the state on a number of issues, whether it's stormwater management or flood control or other things like that. The state, the governor had a process a couple of years back. It was the water they did a water strategic planning process. And we were the only municipality invited. In fact, I was specifically invited to be a member of that group developing that plan. So the invitation actually was to me. So I sat in on that process for 2 years. And, you know, it was hard because sometimes there's conflicting goals. And also the state doesn't necessarily know what it takes to deliver water to a customer. Their concern is the water as a larger volume. And they don't necessarily deal with water on the retail end of it. And so there can sometimes be, you know, it's a learning process for both sides, but we work hard to coordinate and to at least stay in touch. There, in fact, the State Division of Water Resources is partnering with us. We're going to be doing a commercial water audits, so interior audits for a variety of commercial types of businesses, so that we can gain improved information about how certain kinds of businesses use water and how we can help them be more efficient. And both the State Division of Water Resources and the Central Utah Water Conservancy District are partnering with us and helping by bringing some money to the table and some resources. So we collaborate. Central Utah is going to be helping us fund, they're going to be funding a landscape rebate program for us, because we're a retail water provider and we don't have those kind of money. I literally would have to raise rates just so I could give you money back for a rebate, which is, I don't know how folks feel about it. So we do try to work hard with the state.
Good.
And other water agencies. Was that?
That's a great answer. Everywhere you look in Salt Lake City, you see new construction and building. According to your website, there were 1,468 new permits for water in the first 6 months of this year. How does that impact? I mean, they're not making more water. No. So how does that impact our future?
Well, for one thing, keep in mind, we didn't start planning for our water future this year or even last year. We've been doing water planning for about the last 100 years, 150 close to. So Salt Lake City has been acquiring water rights, building reservoir and other storage capacity, building redundancy and capacity into our system. Because one way a community can be short of water isn't just that they don't have enough water, but they don't have the capacity to deliver the water that's being demanded. So the utilities worked hard. We work all the time about making sure that our supply is dependable and resilient. So our current master plan, which includes information about the prison and the inland port and densification, plans water use out the next 40 years. Part of that is that we need to reduce water, though, by another 16,000 acre feet as a regular conservation practice. So conservation is built into that planning process. We are looking at potential new supplies through reuse water, which is water that's used from the reclamation facility after it's been treated. The complexity there is that water is also some of the only fresh water going into the Great Salt Lake. So as a member of this community, we want to be mindful that whatever decisions we make have as little or no negative environmental impact as possible. So we're always looking at that unintended consequence. Densification concerns me. I mean, you hear from someone going, well, yeah, but there was a lawn there before and now there's just apartments, so they use less water. Well, yeah, but if the lawn was a park strip and now there's 800 units, that's not an even trade. So that's why indoor water use is going to become so critical to us, because that base water use, that's going to push up our peak demand. And peak demand is what helps keep our community really resilient, but also the cost of the utility down. Because for instance, all the work they're doing down 900 South, one of the things that they're doing is replacing some water lines or repairing them. Had we had to increase that to create more capacity, that project would have cost $20 million more. Because of conservation, we've gained capacity in those conduits, so we don't have to make them bigger. So when we conserve, we save money for the utility so that we can have things like conservation programming. As far as how we plan for it, one of the things I'm looking at is how do we meter the water use at an apartment complex or in a high-rise office building? Because typically there's only one meter going to that facility, or there might be 2 meters, maybe three, but every unit isn't metered. So how do we know more accurately how much water is being used at an individual unit? How do we help with things like leak detection? And how do we get them a message, because they don't get a bill? So how do I reach them? So these are all the things we're exploring. And I'm part of a group that's called the Alliance for Water Efficiency. And it's a nonprofit that is populated with water scientists, researchers, analysts, water conservation people, and folks a heck of a lot smarter than me who've been. And so we have a number of research and educational committees, and we share information. And this is one of the areas we're actually doing direct research right on right now, in terms of the issue of submetering, is how do we do submetering so we can, because you can't control what you can't measure or see. So we need, I need meters. I need eyes on these places. And that's what my goal is. So how do we, because then we know how to manage that supply and demand.
Well, we've gone over on our open mic.
Holy cow. I told you guys when we started, I could go on for hours. Bad me.
Dylan.
So real quick, next week, we will have Joseph Kim, who is a professor at the University of Utah, who studies mental health and particularly mental health as it relates to social isolation, and which is a big topic of interest, particularly as we're coming out of the last year. So next week, we will be joined by Joseph Kim, who will be talking with us about the impact of social isolation on mental health and well-being of older adults.